2020, the world is hit by a pandemic that it's not prepared to handle.
A SARS-like virus, which has infected hundreds in China.
Concerns about the deadly coronavirus.
We now know there are confirmed cases in 35 countries.
We have therefore made the assessment that COVID-19 can be characterized as a pandemic.
The healthcare industry is desperately looking for something that can fight the novel virus and save people's lives. And then suddenly a study comes out that claims that the cure was in front of us all along. A Nobel Prize winning drug that could save thousands of lives. We're talking about ivermectin, presented as a miracle drug against COVID by the media and healthcare experts. Some doctors even started prescribing ivermectin to their patients. But a graduate student changed the fate of this popular COVID-19 treatment protocol. His curiosity led the scientific community to launch investigations for exposing flawed COVID-19 treatments. And while reading those investigations, I came across what was probably one of the greatest and most dangerous scams pulled off during the pandemic. Hi, my name is Pranav, you're watching Science's Dope, and in today's video, we're gonna uncover the story of a mysterious medical company, a doctor of Indian origin, and his attempt to fool even the World Health Organization.
Closing out a week that has seen more new COVID cases in America.
In India, the pandemic continues to worsen with more than 200,000.
We continue to cover the controversy now surrounding a drug that some have used to treat COVID-19.
You'd be surprised at how many people are taking it.
Both Riverside Health and Sentara have banned the use.
None of these drugs work on the Wuhan virus. They were all useless.
It's 2008 and Sapan Desai, a young 29-year-old vascular surgeon from Chicago, has just received his residency at Duke University, North Carolina. But his dreams lie beyond the walls of the hospital. He wants to make a name for himself as a successful doctor entrepreneur. So while working as a full-time resident at the hospital, he starts a company called Surgisphere Corporation. For the first few years, the company just produces and markets textbooks for medical students. After a while, he launches a crowdfunding campaign on Indiegogo for a wearable health device with the tagline, "Next generation human augmentation device that can help you achieve what you never thought was possible." In 2013, inspired by the new fields of big data and machine learning, Desai comes up with a new idea. What if he could do something with data science that the medical field had never seen before? What if he replaced the long and expensive clinical trials required for drug and vaccine approvals with trials that solely relied on data points and not human participants? Little did he know that his dreams were gonna come true 7 years later. We are now in 2020 in the middle of a pandemic. A novel severe respiratory infection causing virus is spreading across the continents like wildfire. The healthcare industry is overworked, trying to save as many lives as possible. And the research sector is also trying to keep up with the pace, coming up with new ways of diagnosing and treating this novel virus. Peer review, which is the first line of defense for maintaining the scientific reliability of journals, is under a lot of pressure because research papers are being generated at a rate like never before. Unknown to the rest of the world, another crisis was slowly creeping into the field of research. Faulty COVID-19 studies and high-profile scientific scandals. This COVID-19 pandemic saw the highest rise in costs of medical care in the country, as high as 14% in 2021, which is the highest among Asian countries. It's impossible to go through life without a proper health and term insurance. But at the same time, buying insurance is not easy. It's complicated, often messy, and I don't know what's the right plan for me. I'm getting spam calls and messages from insurance companies and agents to buy their insurance all the time. How do you navigate through this mess? Well, that's where the sponsor of this video comes in. Ditto Insurance. What is Ditto? It's a new age insurance platform for millennials where they simplify insurance and help people buy the best plans in the market. Now, what makes them special is how they do it. You can go to their website, book a free call and get honest advice on what plan available in the market is best for you. Or if you have a plan and want to change it, they can help you with that too. Not only is this advice absolutely free, but you'll never get spam calls or messages ever. They have a strict no spam policy. You can also talk to their advisors on WhatsApp. I have personally used Ditto and would instantly recommend it to anyone who wants an insurance policy, which is why I was really glad when they offered sponsorship for this video. They also offer educational tools on their website to break down complexities like insurance jargon. And they help with documentation and claim settlements if you buy the policy through them. So what are you waiting for? There's a link in the description. Back to the video. In 2015, the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine was awarded for the discovery of ivermectin, a drug for treating infections by parasites in humans and animals. So when ivermectin came into the limelight again as a drug for reducing the effect of the COVID-19 infection, many health officials were quick to accept it as a treatment since this medicine was already being used and had no adverse side effects. And the reason this idea of ivermectin was getting pushed was because of a preprint of a clinical trial from a reputed university in Egypt. This study recruited 600 participants and some were given ivermectin and some weren't. The trial showed a 94% recovery rate for patients with a severe disease who were treated with ivermectin. These results came like a ray of sunshine during those desperate times.
Woo! Yeah, baby!
But something sinister was hiding behind the study and would have gone unnoticed for a long time, if not for a biomedical graduate student called Jack Lawrence from the University of London. Jack's professor assigned him to analyze the ivermectin paper since it was one of the largest COVID-19 treatment-related clinical trials. As Jack started reading through the paper, he spotted some major red flags. A lot of content seemed plagiarized from other papers he read on the topic. After double-checking and confirming his doubts, he reached out to experts and scientific data detectives to help him out. And guess what they discovered? Not just the text content, but even the data of the ivermectin trials were faulty and unethical. For instance, the calculations they presented were incorrect. And the local health body whose patient data they apparently used wasn't aware that such a study was being conducted. And you know what's the most terrible part? The study enrolled COVID patients who were already dead even before the trial began. And such patients were only added to the control group that didn't receive ivermectin, only to show that not receiving ivermectin increased fatality rates. This expose led scientists to take a closer look at other ivermectin related protocols. And they found several other papers with very weak evidence to support their claims. And guess whose name popped up among those papers? Sapan S. Desai, the founder of Surgisphere Corporation. This ivermectin study, however, wasn't Desai's world-changing masterstroke. It was another on a drug that popped up as a promising COVID-19 cure and promoted by Donald Trump.
Many doctors think it is extremely successful, the hydroxychloroquine.
Hydroxychloroquine. Or HCQ. Surgisphere, which remained in the background for almost 10 years, was now making headlines. In the early 2020s, a few studies showed that the anti-malarial drug HCQ could be repurposed to treat COVID-19. And soon, India, US, Poland, and many other countries in Europe approved the use of HCQ in emergency or clinical trial settings. Even WHO started enrolling for the HCQ arm of their solidarity trial for COVID-19 treatments. But soon everything changed when a big multinational study came out in the Lancet stating that the use of HCQ was associated with an increased risk of death and heart conditions for COVID-19 patients. And this massive analysis with a sample size of 96,000 involving 671 hospitals spanning every continent except Antarctica was headed by none other than Surgisphere. The once savior drug had now turned into a public enemy. Mind you, this is a database study and not a clinical trial. But this study had a huge impact. Healthcare policies all across the world were changed. WHO put a halt to its solidarity trial and the media was reporting on this groundbreaking research. They said boasted that this was one of the biggest AI and big data powered COVID-19 studies. He even went on news channels saying things like,
"A study of this scale and quality is only possible with the kind of technology we've created at Surgisphere through a cloud-based data analytics system. The real question here really is, with data like this, do we even need a randomized controlled trial?"
Also, getting accepted in a top journal like The Lancet just added to its legitimacy. But this did not stop curious scientists from looking into it. Curious scientists were just amazed that this company that no one had heard of was able to collect patient data for almost 100,000 people across the world. And by now you would have guessed by the theme of this video that this study was not what it was claiming to be. It was a very elaborate scam pulled off by Sergisvia and three doctors from reputed institutions. So within a week of the paper going online, 120 doctors and scientists signed an open letter to The Lancet, raising concerns for the authenticity of the paper. There are over 13 points which you can go through in the link, but I'll touch upon four of them that caught my eye. One, the number of in-hospital deaths in Australia that the study reported was only from 5 hospitals. And this was way more than the total number of COVID deaths that happened in the entire country. Two, almost 25% of their data was from Africa. But the regional scientists doubted that finding so much data on African patients would be impossible, because many hospitals do not have means to store online patient records that can easily be accessed. Three, there was no proper mention of the countries to the hospitals that contributed to Sergisvia's data, even in the acknowledgements, which was rather odd. And four, the authors did not adhere to the golden rule of machine learning and statistical studies, which is that they refused to share both the code and the data. After this appeal was sent to The Lancet, this dodgy study caught the radar of institutions like The Guardian, The Scientist, and the Pulitzer Center, who dug pretty deep and uncovered a bunch of skeletons in the closets of Sergisvia and its founder. For starters, remember the textbook venture of Sergisvia back in 2008? Well, the quality of the books were not only below standard, but the company also posted fake 5-star reviews on Amazon under the names of renowned doctors without their permission. The next generation human augmentation device that Desai advertised on Indiegogo never reached its funders' homes. As of 2019, Sapan Desai has 3 medical malpractice cases against him. Sergisvia's website is inaccessible now, but when it was working, their contact us page led to a crypto website. So how the hell did hospital data for the study even reach them? The other 3 co-authors only laid their eyes on the summarized data and were never given the raw data, which is a standard practice in studies that deal with a huge amount of data. But it is not standard practice to release the data, even when your co-authors are explicitly asking for it so that they can carry out a legit data audit. And finally, this study endangered public health by misleading countries to change their treatment policies and halt their hydroxychloroquine trials. And what happened to HCQ? Well, it went back to Web 1, back to its efficacy being tested. And as the vaccine and more medications for COVID-19 rolled out, the desperation that the healthcare industry faced, which led to this kind of a slip up, slowly died down. But there is something we can all learn from this incident. After all this came to light, Lancet retracted the paper on the grounds of serious concerns, but by then a lot of harm was already done. Not only to public health, but also to the perception of science and research. Whenever this kind of mishap happens in science, people who peddle pseudoscience use this as an opportunity. They highlight it as an inefficiency of science and present their alternative medicine or whatever pseudoscience they're peddling as the solution. I want to present such topics too and make it clear that the alternative to fraudulent science is not pseudoscience, it's better science. Like the vaccine trials, which followed a rigorous scientific protocol. Various independent institutions from all across the globe carried out multi-phase trials for COVID-19 vaccines. The vaccines for multiple variants got tested across thousands of participants using the appropriate randomized double-blind placebo-controlled trial. If you want to understand how these RCT trials take place, I've done a video on just that. If you like this video, you might also like another one I did on the idea that water can remember what was dissolved in it. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, remember, science is dope. Guys, don't forget to check out Ditto Insurance, link in the description or in the top comment.